3 and 2 and 1, thanks for joining. We started with the face of Luca. It took us to Lusus. And from Lusus it gave us Elysium, showing us the connection of what we call Christianity. We looked into Elysium, the idea of life after death, rebirth. Alright, here it leads to Lusus. So again, face of Luca leads to Lusus. And when you go for Lusus and add the word God, you get this particular image. As you can see, it's all Wiktionary or Wikimedia, but not, you know, Wikipedia. So it's kind of like this is being hidden to a degree. Again, it's under the information that deals with Portuguese and stuff. Scrolling down, different ways to, again, however many different tribes are living in this area, they all have a different name for this same exact character. This is Lusus, the Roman god from the word game. We know this game of Rome is the Olympics. This will come up very soon. Even Luso is known as Lusus. He is a Roman god, so Lusus is the Roman name, period. So it doesn't matter that somebody calls it Luca, right? And the Lusus belongs to the, what, Edom, Kittim, and Latinium, right? So he is the son and companion to Bacchus. And it will be very clear as we read further. Now again, it tells us to also see Lusitania, that's presumably the land, and Lusitanio. Right? An uncertain etymology too may be from Lucius. Right? So again, like one of the viewers said, Lucius trust. Again, it's all the same character. Over the years, you've heard me say Monobail Zeus and this and that. It's still the same character. In the Bible, it says Lucifer. This is what they are talking about. Now, when we go to Os Lusíadas. Now, this is considered an epic poem. Okay? When we read later, we're going to read that it's considered on par with the Odyssey, the Iliad, the Aeneid. So this is another one of these books that are written by a peoples likened to the Bible or wanting to be compared with the Bible. I would look, what I'm gonna read is astonishing because of the dates, because what we've been told from history versus what we're about to see chronicled as a people's history. Now they're going to keep saying, oh, it's a myth, it's a poem, it's this, it's that. It doesn't matter what they say it is, because Our lives are based on this. Now, what if I told you Christianity existed before this so-called Christ died? What if I told you this poem, right, with 1,102 stanzas? Let's just read. You don't have to believe me. You can hear it for yourself. You can see it for yourself. It is usually translated as the Lusíadas. Okay? It is a Portuguese poem written by Luís Vaz de Camões. All right? It was the first published in 1572. It was widely regarded as the most important work of Portuguese, of the Portuguese language literature, or of Portuguese language literature, and is frequently compared to Virgil's Aeneid. So this is the Aeneid, the Latin poem written by Virgil, and tells the legendary story of Aeneas. Now, Aeneas, I have up in another tab. I don't want to bring that tab up because it just, all right, so Jashir, G, Aegeus, Aegean, Aegeus. It doesn't matter, right? Now, in the book of Jashir, right? Let's see. See the Aegean Sea or Aegeus. Let's say Aegeus. Let's see what it says. Let me see what the dude's name is. Let me go back to this one. Okay, so here we have Aegeus. Aegeus, king of Africa. And Latinus prevailed over. Right, so the Latins and Aegeus. Now, when we read, excuse me, I lost my little spot. We were in Iliad, right? Near Aeneas instead of Aegeus. Who tells the legendary story of Aegeus, a Trojan who fell the fall of Troy and traveled to Italy. Excuse me, who fled. Okay, so if we read it from the book of Jashir, it's Aegeus, the king of Africa. And the story is in Jashir chapter 60. And let's see. See what we get first. Chapter 60. And Zepho enticed the king of Africa to collect his army and to go fight the Egyptians. Right? And here, somebody tries to, right, have it make sense. So imagine you're reading right here, the Aeneid, and it's Aeneas. Right? Where he became the ancestor of the Romans. So you have the African king. Now again, just because I say African, don't think that it's going to be modern African. Could be. I'm just saying, just don't fall for that right away. So many groups have switched places over time, right? Now, basically, the work celebrates the discovery of the sea route to India by the Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama. The 10 cantos of the poem are a ovia rima. So It is a rhythm, a rhyming stanza form of Italian origin. Originally used for long poems on heroic themes, it later became came to be popular in writing of mock heroic works. Its earliest known use is the writing of Giovanni Boccaccio, something like that. So as we can see, during this time of writing is to celebrate. All right. So it is not to mock. All right. So this is written more towards the time of originally. All right. So as we go further, when written in Homeric, all right, Homeric. So Homer, the ancient author and poet, is reputed author of the Iliad and the Odyssey. Okay? The two epic poems. Now, if you have the time and you want to know exactly why people are sending the world onto this path, then you want to type in the Odyssey. Right? And you can go for the movie, you're not going to get it. I don't think it's going to happen with the movie. All right? Again, the full audiobook is 12 hours long. You really think you're going to get it in a book? I mean, in a movie? So, when we look at the Iliad audiobook, part one of two, right? The Iliad, full book, 21 hours long. What the hell is going to be said in these books that are worth 30 hours of material? I mean, listen, with all due respect, what could be said in here that's so important? Right? Again, it's a record of a war that took 10 years. So just think about that for a little bit. So again, we are looking at the Lusíadas, and we can see if anybody's had any interest in this, right? And okay, so here we have it is written in Spanish. It's 7 hours, 6.5 hours. All right, there does not seem to be an English translation so far as we can see. This one might. See the hour difference too? That could be translated. So, to some people in this world, this is the most important thing ever. All right. Again, this poem focuses on the fantastic interpretation of the Portuguese voyages of discovery during the 15th and 16th centuries. It is often regarded as Portugal's national epic, much as Virgil's Aeneid was for ancient Romans, and Homer's Iliad and Odyssey. And again, we didn't even look at what the Aeneid, how long it is as a listen as an audio book. Again, imagine the time you live in. You don't even have to learn how to read. You can just have everything played to you if you can figure out how to type the shit in. Okay, so the Aeneid, Virgil's book, is 11 hours. I really don't know what to say about that. I don't. Okay, so it was written in cameos. Was in exile in Macau. Right, so this is the Republic of China, right? It's in the Western Pearl River Delta. Okay, so when, not gamma, well, whatever. So they were in Asia, and it was first printed in 1572, 3 years after the author returned from the Indies. All right, so we're gonna go down. The poem consists of 10 cantos. Now, cantos is a principal form of division in medieval and modern long poetry. Now, each with a different number of stanzas. You can see 11,000 there. I mean, 1,100 there. It is written in the decasyllabic, right? A rhyming stanza of Italian origin, which has the rhyme scheme A B A B A B C C. All right. Musicians should understand that verse, chorus, verse, and contains a total of 8,816 lines of verse. The poem is made up of four sections: an introduction, all right, presentation of the scene, the heroes of the poem, right? That is the proposition of it. Invocation, a prayer to the Tagetes. These are nymphs of Tagus. So you see, these are women that are naked in water. It's a Greek folklore. It's a minor female nature deity. Okay? Different from Greek goddesses, nymphs are generally regarded as personifications of nature. They are typically tied to a specific place or land form and are usually depicted as beautiful maidens. They were not necessarily immortal, but live much longer, presumably, than man, right? So, as it's said there, they are making prayers to these things, right? There's a dedication section to Sebastian of Portugal. He was the king of Portugal during this time, the monarch of the House of Avias, right? The narration, the epic itself, starting in stanza 19 of Canto 1, in medias res, right? Then there's a word beginning in the medias res, opens in the midst of the plot, often exposition. All right, so it is a way of writing in the expedition, the narration, right? And this is why it happens in the beginning. It is the, right? It opens in the midst of the plot, right? So they open with the, in the, right? On the water. Right, with background story being told later in the epic, so like Pulp Fiction, right? So the narration concludes with an epilogue, starting with stanza 145 of Canto 10. I'm presuming that's 10. That's Greek, but excuse me, that's wrong. But I don't know if it's gonna really work here, unless these guys are secretly wrong. I don't know. Who cares? The most important part of O Lusitas is the arrival in India. It was placed at the point in the poem that divides the work according to the golden section at the beginning of Canto 7. The golden section in mathematics, two quantities are in the golden ratio if their ratio is the same. So it's just saying equally can balance, right? No, not quite, right? If the ratio is the same as the ratio of their sum, the larger of the two qualities, right? Yeah. All right, so the heroes of the epic are the Lusiads or the Lusiadas, right? And the sons of Lusus. All right. It is the supposed son or companion of Bacchus. Okay, so again, it'd be a good point. We've already looked at Bacchus. When you bring up Bacchus, it takes you to Dionysus. Dionysus. It's Dion. Dionysus. All right. So you can see right there the Yeezus or Yeezys. So this is why Jay-Z put that shit up there, right? So anybody that doesn't understand history, it throws it right in your face, right? So you can simply go over here and open this up and you say you want the names, right, of, and you can say Zeus. So yeah, call him Jupiter, they call him Jove. Now you can say the names of Baal. Again, the Greeks are calling him one thing, the Romans are calling him another thing, and the Hebrews are calling him something different. Of course, Canaanites are calling them something. Everybody's calling them something different. So, or names of Baal, Zeus, or did I do Zeus Baal before? Oh, it's not coming up the same way. Probably won't again. Probably come the same way again. It's been changed. Whatever. So they're not gonna show his son's names and stuff. All right, Baal was usually said to be the son of Dagon. All right, so that should extend a lot of people. Who is the father of Yam? Right, again, Yam is Pisidian. Right? So, this is just silliness. Right? They named the in Dragon Bell. So, again, that's not fair to say it that way. So, just think about this. You already know, like, the different names of Baal. I can't believe it's not gonna. I can't. I didn't write it up the way it before. It's just gonna keep coming up the same bullshit. All right, so let me go back over here. And again, these are just the sons of Lusus, right? All right, so this is what the Lusitanians are, okay? So, in other words, the Portuguese. So they're saying, again, if you read this and at some point you sit there and say, dude, these are just the Luciferians, man. This is Lucifer of the Bible, right? You again, they sit there and say, oh, the Baal to Yam, right? We just saw this. I clicked a different one, but it doesn't matter. It's just going to say the same thing. One had to be opened and then it extends. Right. Serpent. Right. So when we go back here and it sits there, it says, all right, they are the sons. It's just saying they are the sons of the serpent. If Lucius is the son of Bacchus, Bacchus is Dionysus, whatever, Isis, it's the same shit. Yeah, I don't give a shit. They got 50 names for the same guy. You gotta get over that shit. All right, all these people die worshiping the snake, the child of the snake. Right. The initial strophes of Jupiter's speech in Council des Deuses Olympius, right? The Council of the Olympian Gods, which open the narrative part, highlight the laudatory orientation of the author. Now, Jupiter, we know who he is. Jupiter, also known as Jove, is this god of the sky, the thunder king of, right? King of the gods of ancient Rome. I mean, we know who this is. It's no different. So, we just saw it over here. It's the same shit. Again, the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or likeness of anything that is in the heaven above. That means when this character says, I am the God of the sky, that's the heaven above. So this is a graven image to a false god. This was just a man. He was a beast. He was a Haya. A being purposely created to fuck over man. I made a man, I made a lion into a man, put a heart on him, put the eagle. This is a very good representation of what's being written. Because down the line, your generation, remember, this is what they dealt with in the past. They put swine, Zeus, pig. S-U-S is a gene of pig. Gene, chromosome. Same family. Genus. So, in these strophes, now again, the initial strophes of Jupiter's speech, Cameo speaks of Veritas, okay? The leader of the most important leader of the Luciferians, the Lusitan. Get the fuck out of here. And Quintus Ceterosis, and the people of Lusus. The Lusitanians were an Indo-European speaking people living in the west of the Iberian Peninsula prior to its conquest by the Roman Republic and its subsequent incorporation of the territory into the Roman province of Lusitania. Right? A people predestined by the fates. What are the fates? Okay, they were female personifications of destiny. So, you know, up here where they're like praying to fucking personifications of nature. These are personifications of the future. So they are fucking fortune tellers. So these people were told by the spirit fortune tellers that what? That they would accomplish great deeds. Now, check this shit out. Timeline. Okay, everybody grab your timeline and make sure this sounds like chronological order. Now, Jupiter himself says that their history. So here's Jupiter and here's the Lusitanians becoming these people. And Jupiter is going to talk about these people, and that will be written in the first things of this, the cantos of this stanza. Really? That kind of make it sound like it wasn't so long ago when everybody kind of lived at the same time. It kind of doesn't sound like we lived 6,000 years on the earth or 10,000 years. It sounds like we've been living 1,000 years, and somebody like a xylophone just stretches it all out, right? That's not a xylophone, but whatever. So, Jupiter, who is Jove, who is Zeus, who is Baal, who is the father of Serapis Crustus, right? So, and then, right? But Serapis Crustus is just a statue of who? Bacchus or Lusus, right? I don't know what to tell you. You know, I'm sure anybody watching that wants to argue this is bullshit, there's their moment. But it's not. You know it's not. We got the liars over and over in history. We spotted their lies. We spotted their lies. So Jupiter says that their history proves it. The Lusitanians having emerged victorious against the Moors and the Castilians. The Moors and the Castilians. That shit happened in 900, right? Ooh, so this is a good point to say, because again, this is the Moors in Spain, right? The Moors exiled from Spain. Oh, expelled. My bad. Same difference, right? 1492. Thought they were already here in America. When were the Moors expelled, right? Spain's conquest of the Iberian Peninsula, the end of Granada. See, this is the point of your black community is fucking bullshit. How many times could anybody black being talked shit to by the boys? Could have typed this in and ended all that chicken little talk a long time ago. The Moors is indigenous. How embarrassing. How embarrassing. Is it? Every time this motherfucker's name up, he's just ripping their little clubhouse to shit. What's that scripture that's always telling this the truth? Moors are liars? Yeah. So, here you have what? So I guess the next question is the Lusitanians versus the Moors. Right? Spain, Moor to Lusitania, huh? Along the roads of Lusitania, Spanish peasants, last week we saw the sight of white men not seen in 450 years. Uh-oh, this isn't going so good for, you know, the Moors. Lusitania, or it was called Hispania, right? So see, Lusitania has been kind of hidden because, of course, the fucking Bible came out, and right in the middle of the Bible, they said Lucifer, right? And they were like, we can't use that name anymore. I'll call it Hispania. So fucking Virgil sits there and says, huh? Hispania is the home of the Goths, right? And it's the Lusitanians. The fucking Romans didn't call it the province of Hispania. They called it the province of what? Lusitania. Was the ancient Iberian Roman province located where modern Portugal? Okay. Right. Well, what year did they fight that what? That this motherfucker is going to be alive to document it. Jupiter himself, Baal, Zeus, says that their history proves it. How the fuck can their history prove it if the actions allegedly happen after he's dead? So the actions could not have happened at the fucking date that we call 1492. This has got to be the point of everybody that joins this damn league has to accept the Gregorian calendar and the extension of the truth that then makes it lies. So the exact same time they kicked the Moors out of in Europe is the exact same time they say, well, let's just go to America and colonize it. How romantic. This tiny nation has gone on to discover new worlds, really the same time as you expel your enemies. The same enemies you're over here buddy buddy with. And Jupiter is alive to see, all right, alive to quote the destruction of the Iberian Peninsula from the Moors and hand it over to the Lusitanians and the Hispanias, right? This tiny nation, right? Discover the new world. At the end of the poem, on the island of love. Now, again, they're saying, damn near 100 years later, they're over here in America, right? When is this supposed to be taking place? It was printed in 1572. This is after the discovery, right? Can you believe this shit? You're telling me you discovered America. Look at this. When this shit, right, is written in 524, right? 1524. Right? Remember, he's quoting, right? Jupiter. And Jupiter says, the Moors and Castilians. Again, anybody, when did the Castilians arrive? Right. The rise of Castilian and Aragon, right? What year? So the Castilians start to rise in the 1100s, and of course, when do the Castilian end? I mean, if we scroll down, is it going to say society failed? Almode. That's Alfonso of Aragon, treaty with Islamic Spain to still retain the right of conquest of Andalusia and Mauritania. Right, there's your more paradise, Mauritania. Mer, right? There's your fucking homeland. Huh? Always say, go to every Moore's video that says that they're indigenous and write this word. Mer is ya. There's your Yah, your Yahweh, right? Don't the Moors worship the moon? This shows you they had a hand in putting the word Yah, the false name Yahweh. Anybody who's this far behind doesn't understand Yah, the Egyptian moon god. When I go to people's channel and people comment, praise Yah! Like, do you even you know what you're doing? Again, not all people that are dark skinned are the same nation. So, very easy to see. You see the Moors in there. There's your Yahweh. There's your Yahweh. Sabbath and the moon ain't even the same thing. On the moon cycle, you the Sabbath is the following day. The following day. It's not even the same thing. How embarrassing is it? See, I hate doing this shit. You think God likes thugs? God makes laws. Does thugs follow laws? No, they don't follow laws. That's why they're called thugs. Thug love and love from God are they're actually opposite ends. You think God wants you talking like a street thug? Yo, nigga, you think God wants you talking like this? You think God wants you acting hard, acting street tough, acting like you're fucking carrying, all right, and you're not, and then somebody else is offended by you and they're carrying, and then you're shot? Corn King, that rhymed. This is embarrassing. You have all this access to knowledge, and again, the melanated person that is tricked into believing that they're slaves off a ship talks embarrassing. You won't raise yourself up. Even the Moors have this in front of you. Talk like they're ghetto, but in front of everybody else, talk like they're sophisticated. And that's the problem. You don't understand the idea that ancient Israel had a nobility that they lost. Versus today, you want to be Israel, but you're lost. You're lost in the mind. You're lost in the body. You're lost in the spirit. You're chasing frequencies. And a lot of people are using energies or chasing energies, not in the same idea of putting your energy towards things. In the same idea that these people have tricked you into being one step away from Kabbalah mentality. Reach out to the ancestors, people. What the fuck is wrong with these people? The ancestors don't like that. You should be speaking your ancestors' language. Oh my God, dude, what's wrong with these people? Always saying the same version, just a branch from the root of bullshit and wickedness. What does voodoo do? A call on your ancestors to come in. The fuck is the difference? They give you a voodoo mentality and then you defend it like you're fucking righteous. And you're not. You're just saying stupid shit. It's entertaining. If I was them, I would be entertained because I would say, look at all the money I invested in fucking them over. They wouldn't put two and two together and go to court and sue for disenfranchisement because they're too fucking stupid. And then you have other dumbasses online coming in here and telling you, well, you just need grandma's word. And what is grandma's word going to do? It's going to keep you out of fucking court. And you go to court and you with no papers, no papers, no papers at all, no pedigree. What's the first thing they want to know? Who's your father? I don't know who my daddy is. I ain't give a fuck about that motherfucker. Mommy didn't give a fuck about that motherfucker. So that's the mentality you go with? Dad walked out when I was fucking 12, man. Fuck that nigga. That's the mentality. Okay, who's your dad's dad? Man, if I ain't give a fuck about him, why give a fuck about somebody else? That's your mentality. Now, how is you gonna prove you related to anybody in this book? There's a book from England that shows you how everybody of nobility in this Bible connects to Europe. If they can connect the heritage from the Bible to Dark Age, right? Dark skin Europe, then it ain't that hard to connect dark skin Europe to dark skin America. Again, the nobility came and hid the people of Europe, white and black, came to the land with intentions on marrying in to the Indians. When they couldn't, they paid their way if they could. For some, there was no need because they were in servitude and the land was opened up to them after their servitude. This is the Homestead Act. The 40 acres in a mule happened everywhere. But when you have so many, America, right? The East Coast to the West Coast, when you start giving so many houses away and so much land and property, especially on Indian land, then you have to say, now you have to go past the Mississippi to acquire your land. Imagine the Homestead Act only happened for a certain amount of time, right? But slavery happened for 150 years up until that, with the contractual negotiation that after 7 years, the Jubilee, you would be free and own a portion. This is what they're not telling you because they're sculpting you into a psychotic fucking idiot. And you're okay with it because a lot of people have been taught to not respect themselves. And look at what rap has done to your communities and your moms and your dads. They all let you do whatever you wanted. Idle time becomes the devil's ears, airwaves, king of the air, god of the air. So, this tiny nation bullshit, at the end of the poem, on the island of love, the fictional finale to the glorious tour of Portuguese history. He writes that fear once expressed by Bacchus has been confirmed, that the Portuguese would become gods. Now again, if Bacchus is the father of Lusus and the Lusitanians are the children, right, that then Bacchus is the grandfather of these people, why would he fear that his people, right, his descendants would become gods? That sounds fucking ridiculous, doesn't it? The extraordinary Portuguese discoveries and the new kingdom that they exalted so much in the East, so this is in India, and certainly the recent and extraordinary deeds of the strong Castro. Castro Forte, the Viceroy Daniel de Castro, right, a Portuguese nobleman, scientist, writer, fourth Viceroy of Portuguese India, and he called Castro Fort, he was called Castro Forte by the poet Luis de Camos. De Castro was the second son of Alvaro de Castro, the civil governor of Lisbon, Portugal. Okay, so he had died some years before the poet's arrival to the Indian lands, right? So they were in the act of stealing other people's shit, and he admired this man so much, he was sad that he died before he got to meet him, right? Where the decisive factors in Camilo's completion, something like that, of the Portuguese epic. Camilo's dedicated his masterpiece to the King Sebastian of Portugal. The narrators and their speeches. A vast majority of narration on the Os Lusíadas consists of grandiloquent speeches by various orators. The main narrator, Da Gama, recognized as elegant captain, right? Paulo Da Gama, and then Thetis or something like that. Thetis is a sea nymph, right? And a siren. So understand, they're saying the main narration is from a human, a sea nymph, and a sea siren, right? Dangerous creatures. You know what these are. These are the women that slept, fucked the fallen angels, and got cursed to be in this shape. They sing lullabies to sailors with their music to lure them onto rocky coasts, right? It is said they can even charm the winds, the airwaves, right? So, now, look at this. Roman poets placed them on small islands called blah, blah, blah. So, they even know where these things are. Exactly where they are. Okay, the siren who tells the future in Canto 10, I'm assuming that's 10, since this is Rome. The poet asks the Tagetes, the nymphs of the river of Tagus, to give him a high and sublime sound, a grandiloquent and flowing style, in contrast to the style of lyric poetry or humble verse. He is thinking about this exciting tone of orality. Now remember, you live in a society full of music. Where do you think a lot of this stuff comes from? Humans get burned out fast. Imagine, after 3 months of being in a studio, constantly working with someone over and over again. So, there are in the poem some speeches that are brief but notable, including Jupiter's and the old man of Restellos. Okay, again, they keep saying that there are speeches from this character. Again, it's a fiction because the ending. It's a fiction because he's talking to spirits, or he's claiming that he's talking to spirits, and he's claiming that he's being rewarded things such as narration, which would mean getting your palm read and then getting an answer. So think about this, and then think about history. There are also descriptive passages like the description of the palaces of Neptune and the Semorim. Now, the Semorim was the hereditary monarch of the kingdom of Kozhikode, Calicut, on the south of Malabar region of India. Calicut was one of the most important trading posts at the peak of... Okay, here it says the Zamorans ruled over the region from Kolum. So, that's pretty interesting, right? Let's start getting some of those names. And here we have Calicut now, known as Kozhikode. Something like that, cozy code. In English, it's Calicut. All right, so that's in India. All right, so again, there's descriptions of the palace of Neptune, palaces of Neptune. So many places of Neptune. Who's giving the description of the Neptune supposed to be under the sea? Right? He's the Greek counterpart to the Greek god. Yeah, right, he's the counterpart to the Greek. He's the same person, right? His brother Jupiter, right? Zeus. And Pluto, Hades. Preside over the realms, heaven, earthly world, and under the sea. So let's go back to the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not make unto thee any other gods, right? Especially, right? Before me, I am a jealous God. I will put this curse on your children in the third and the fourth generation till your rotten ass sits in front of me on judgment day. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or likeness of anything that's in the heaven, or anything that's in the earth, the grave, huh? The hell, the pit, right? Or that is in what? The water. So what is, this is Ass Clown Central right here then, right? Because what do people do? Where did we just get that one from? I lost it. The palaces of Neptune is where we got it from, hitting Neptune, right? Now, where they claim the realms of heaven. Oh, nothing that's in heaven above, huh? And when they say, oh, we claim this, we claim that, huh? And they claim what? The earthly world. That's not what you think. It's not above where we walk. He's claiming, beneath the earth, Hades. That's right, in the Ten Commandments, it say, do not worship Zeus, do not worship Hades, and do not worship Poseidon. Okay? It says it, all right? You see it right there? I got that print up 300%, so your eyeballs don't even have to squint on your little cell phones. So, what's the world doing? To be exact, let's shut up, Spock. They're worshiping exactly what the Most High told them. Do not. That's, yes, that is what Vincent coined again, disgruntled creation. That seems to be what's going on. So, examples of dynamic descriptions include, oh, we forgot some of this. Sorry about that. All right, so, Island of Love, the dinner in the palace of Theseus. Now, Theseus, again, it's a fucking, it's a nymph, a sea nymph. It's a woman. I didn't know that. All right, so she's an important sea nymph because she's a goddess of water. Now, they already said nymphs are not goddesses, but this one, of course, has a palace. All right, and of course, you know, being that, because daughter of the ancient sea god, Nereus. Now, what is Nereus? Who gives a shit? I'm sure it's going to go back to Yam. So she's really claiming, or they're claiming, that she's probably the daughter of Poseidon. Oh, well, that would be worth it since we just opened the Ten Commandments. We should at least take a look, right? So, give me some words. Nerds, Nereus, sea god, Nereus, Nereus, right? Nereus. Nereus is the eldest son of Gaia, the Earth. Ain't that what that bitch keep on worshiping, the Earth? Mother Earth! Come on, child! Ooh, honey! No. You're fucking pagan. Pontus, the sea. Alright? The sea fucked the Earth, and they had a child. Nereus was the oldest son. So, don't you ever see her with, like, Mother Earth? Send me one of your children. Child, honey. How about I go outside? I grab a shovel. And I take a shit right in this earth. And we talk about how you call on this Mother Earth like it's a god. And then we point to the shit I just took on it. Well, that makes sense to you at some point. I have to be foul to get across to pure heathen that would deny my birthright and raise up dirt as a fucking god. So, all right. And so, wait, this dude's the god of the sea. What the hell do I even close that for? Again, that's going to lead back to shit on, right? He lives in the Aegean Sea. Oh, what's this dude's name? Aegeus. Do I make it look easy? It's not easy, it's hard. I got this pain in my fucking back because my shoulders aren't balanced because I'm sitting here crooked like retard. It's okay, I do some stuff sometimes. I'm not mentally challenged. You know what it's like when you just can do, but you don't. So, like, you're stamped as you're in. So, yeah. Okay. So, let's get back to this. I'm the greatest bitch of them all. Oh, oh, oh. The old man of the sea. Is that the old man that they were just talking about in the play? Or in the book? See, again, man, it seems like I'm wasting time, but if I didn't waste that time, we wouldn't know that when they say old man somewhere up here, right? Old man of Wrestler, right? This is it, right here. In the Iliad, the old man of the sea is the father of the Nereids, right? Though Nereus is not directly named, he is ever more satisfied, manifested as the old man of the sea than he is described as a shapeshifter. Wow. The more we sit here and read this, the more exciting it gets. with the power of prophecy. Quarantine. Who would aid heroes such as Hercules, who managed to catch him even as he changed shapes? You, what was he changing to? Nereus and Proteus the first, right? Proton seems to be two manifestations of the god of the sea who was supplanted by Poseidon when Zeus overthrew Kronos. Oh, management team's gonna be removed, right? Yeah, fucking merger. You guys are done. Here's my new crew. Right? This is exactly what we do in politics, right? 4 years, and then what? We get a change, and the whole cabinet is removed. So Zeus overthrew Cronus and removed his cabinet and placed Poseidon. You are now part of my new Supreme Court. It's fucking stupid shit. You can see their little management skills in here. I'm gonna sit back in this chair. You manage this shit. All right. So, and yeah, I lost it. Where were we? We weren't that far down. The heroes. We didn't even get to the heroes yet. So, internal structure. Yeah. I think we did get to the heroes. All right, because I did this to the Moors. All right. Okay, so here we are. So, oh, look, the old man comes up again. Given the sublime, flowing style, extraordinary poem, speeches, brief, including Judah, old man's resto. Okay, we already did see that. Sorry about that. Oh, it did come up again, right down here again. All right, so I think we got Mozambique. Nope, we didn't get that far. We got to the first time Bacchus was brought up. I think we got somewhere in here. Sorry, I'm just wasting time now. All right. Neptune's palaces, right? Sometimes these descriptions, like a slideshow, when someone shows each of these things, describe the example of the geographic start of Gamma's speech to the king of Melinde. Melinde, is that in India? I do not know. So, whatever. Kanto at the... Whoa. And then I lost that. And word that fast, where Melinda go? All right. Certain sculptures of the palaces of Neptune and Samorium. Now, what is Samorium? That's where we were. All right, India. That's what it is. Samorium, and it should say Samoriums. That's what's confusing there, too. And the speech of Paulo Gamma and Catula and the machine of the world. I don't know what that is. Axis Monday is the world, so Mundo is the world, the machine of the world. Don't tell me they're going to argue the machine of the world exists. Some, you know, I've heard people say it before, the world machine. All right, the world machine is the latest book of Portuguese, and it's with their publisher. Okay, so is it's just a book. This world machine is just the book. The examples of dynamic descriptions include the Battle of the Island of Mozambique. So you have an island of Mozambique that's of course off the coast of Africa, right? Yeah. Capital of Portuguese, colonial Portuguese in East Africa. All right, so here it's gonna, you know, get a little funky. Battles of Okori, right? So, now, again, their routes, you see what they're doing in the Battle of Arique, right? Portuguese, kind of Afonso, defeated those led by Almoravid, see the Moors, Almoravid governor of Cordoba, Muhammad as Zubay, whatever, Umar, identified as King Ishmar in the Christian chronicles. Okay, so they're chronicling in this the defeat of the Moors. Camios is a master in these descriptions, marked by the verbs of movement, the abundance of visual and acoustic sensations, and expressive alliterations. There are many lyrical moments. Those texts are normally narrative descriptive. This, in the case with the initial part of the episode of the sad Inez, the final part of the episode of the Adamasur. Adamasur is a mythical character created by this author in his poem that we're reading now as a personification of the Cape of Good Hope, symbolizing the dangers of the sea and formidable forces of nature challenged and ultimately overcome by the Portuguese crew. I'm assuming the word crew is going to be at the end of that. So, asshole for I am, right? And the encounter on the island of love, Cantos 9. All of these cases resemble eclogues. Eclogues is a poem in a classical style on a pastoral subject. Right? On several occasions, the poem assumes a tone of lamentation. At the end of Cantos 1, lamentation, the speech of the old man, lamentation. So the old man is most likely Nereus. All right. At the end of Canto 5, lamentation. At the beginning and at end of Cantos 7, tone of lamentation, the final strokes of the poem, and the final strokes of the poem. Many times, Da Gama busts into oration at challenging moments. In Mombasa, Canto 2, on the appearance of Adabasor, so when the Sea of Good Hope shows itself, personifies itself as some form of image of a man, as they showed you what they see it or show it as, right? A giant, right? And in the middle of the terror of the sea, so I don't know what that is, because they're being ambiguous with it. It could be a monster, it could be a sea storm. The poet's invocations to the Tejiz, right? Supernatural beings and nymphs of the Mondego, Cantos 1 and Cantos 7, and to Calliope. All right, it is a moose who presides over elegance and epic poetry. All right, so he's begging any spirit he can call out, and since he's a writer, he's specifically, all right, asking this one, hey, help me write this shit. In typical terms are also orations. Each of these types of speech shows stylistic peculiarities. All right, so no different than the Hebrews called on their God, these things called on their beliefs. This, of course, is why you have a pantheon, right? Because all of these different tribes that grew into different nations have different beliefs and different nymphs to call on, all right? So, Cantos 1 begins in a dedication section. The poet paying homage to Virgil and Homer. The first line mimics the opening of the Aeneid and pays a hopeful tribute to the young King Sebastio. The story then, in imitation of classical epics, portrays the gods of Greece watching over the voyage of Da Gama. Just as gods have divided loyalties during the voyages of Odysseus and excuse me, Odyssey, yeah, Odysseus and the and Aeneas, that's this cat again. NG is king of Africa. So it does say Odysseus, my bad. Odysseus and where did I go? Anyway, Odysseus and Aeneas. So in the book, I guess they're talking about the Aeneid, right? Just as the gods are, right, the players they put in the center of the Colosseum as they watch from their realm, so to speak, and during the voyages of Odysseus and Aeneas, right? Aeneas was the Trojan hero, son of the Trojan prince Anchises and the Greek goddess Aphrodite. His father was the first cousin to king, cousin of King Priam of Troy, making Aeneas a second cousin to Priam's children. Okay, so we bring up Priam now. Okay, so let's fuck up the whole world. All right, let's go over here and we'll say, show me Paris. Right, of Troy. All right, Paris of Troy. All right. All right. Paris of Troy is also known as Alexander. Oh, I hope you're not talking about Alexander of Greek, right? So he was the son of Priam. Priam was the legendary king of Troy during the Trojan War. He was the son of Laomedon. His many children include notable characters as Hector and Paris. Okay. So, Laomedon of Troy means ruler of the people, was a Trojan king, son of Ilus. All right. There's Ilus. Right. Ilus was the founder of the city called Ilios. Ilium. You know Ilium. Because we're down here calling it an Elysium, right? See all this shit? It's the same shit. Lisa. Mona Lisa. Right? Ilus, son of Troth. Right? But who is Tros? To which gave his name, right? Ilium. Then the latter became the chief of the city of the Trojan people, often called Troy. The name which is best known today. So let's go down. So Ilus was the son and the heir of King Tros of Dardania. All right, so let's see who Tros is. Tros was the founder of the kingdom of Troy, of which the city Illinois, all right. Ill lion, the lion is ill, founded by his son Ilus, took the same name, and his son Erechtheonius, right? So, founded by his son Ilus and took the same name and his son Erechtheonius. Right? So right here again, he was the son. Trios is the son of Erechthonius, right? So Erechthonius of Dardania. Erechthonius was a mythical king of Dardania, the son of Dardanus. Who is Dardanus? Dardanus, son of Zeus. I told you. You don't want to listen. You think I'm fucking crazy. All these different names for the same fucking people. Yeah. Right? Dardanus, who's the brother of Dardanus? Right? Dardanus was the son of Zeus. Right? When he slept with Atlas' daughter. But somebody says, no, it wasn't Atlas's daughter. It's really an Italian king called Cori. Corythus. Corythus, son of Marmaris, Morris, Mari, and one of the court of the owl. You'll get it. He wounded Pylades during the battle at the wedding of the feast of Perseus and Andromeda, right? Oh, shit. That's not the wedding with the half horses, half men, is it? Whatever. So, I don't think it is. I don't know why it came to mind. So, is there family? Alright, so, I'm gonna go up here. Okay, so, now I'm gonna show you Quantum. Now I'm gonna show you how they're trying to hide it. Alright, so we're going to go up here. Dardanus was the son of Zeus, right? But another author says it's really King Cornus of the Italian kingdom. He was the brother of Aeson, right? Sometimes of Harmonia. Don't worry about Harmonia. Worry about Aeson, right? Now listen. Dionysus, right? And we just had Dionysus, right? Dionysus, right? So that's Bacchus, right? So when we read this right here, they just saying Bacchus. Don't fall for this shit, right? No, that's not where we're at. We're all the way down here, right? So Bacchus, right? Oh, no, it's not him. It's the historian. Now, watch this shit. States Dardanus, his original home was Arcadia. When Dardanus and his elder brother, Iasus, you mean Jesus? How do you have Lusus? See? Fuck, it's not even Lusus, is it? I'm adding an L. Look at this. Nope, that's the search criteria. No, it is Lusus, because that's an L. Right? That's me in the search criteria, too. See? But still, you have Lusus, you have the Elysium, you know, right? Luso, all the different ways of this, right? And this, that's a fucking I. See, it's at the beginning, right? Derivative terms. It's a first name. It says Iso, Iuso, right? And you click it, and it takes you right back to this shit. From, is that an L? From the, that's the word game. It's, what, is it an I or an L? Right? Udo or Ludo? Lusa? Lucia? Right? Now, this is the game, the sport. What did it, right? It's 50 cents and the game, right? And the Olympics is a game, and rap is called the rap game. It's all right here. You just, yeah, I don't know. Maybe you have to, maybe they're right. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe I'm insane. Maybe you have to be insane to see it, but it's right here. All right. You see this all over again. Why is Argos important? Right? Over and over again. It's not the same person as everybody using this name, right? We just read this one. It's the same dude. Right? Founder of the mystic rites on the island of Semeltres. Right? Over here, this dude and his brother's being called, he's being same way. Up here, it's written as this. If that's a name, his brother, that's an I. Iason. What did they call him before allegedly this book was printed, right? They called him Iasis or some shit, right? It's the same thing, right? Here, okay, so Dardanus's home was originally in Arcadia, where Dardanus and his elder brother Iasus, elsewhere called Iason, reigned as kings following Atlas. Okay, again, Jesus is king of kings. Iasus is king of kings. Again, it's right here. Dardanus married Chrysler. Right? This is where we get the fucking name Chrysler. Daughter of Pallas. Like Dallas. By whom he fathered two sons, Idaeus and Diomedes. Diomedes. De. Deimos. When the great flood occurred, the survivors who were living on mountains that had now become islands split into two groups. One group remained and took Deimos as king, while the other sailed away and eventually settling in the islands of Samothrace. Now, that's just where we saw that the other dude was from, right? Samothrace. This was accident highlighting this guy, right? Here we have Iasus, the Arcadian father of Atalanta. Come on. If you don't know, this shit is hot. This shit is hot. Come on. Don't even gotta talk this up. It's all right there. We just read it. The fucking if the brother is from Arcadia. And you live in a city called fucking Atlanta. Or if you've heard of a city called Atlanta, come on. Son of King Liar, Lycurgus, right? King of Tiega in Arcadia. The Tiega almost sounding like the fucking nymphs. He's kissing ass too. The Tegean Tagides. Now again, is it the Tagides of Tegea in Arcadia? Right? Here, Isis, father of Nepeta, who married King Olympus and gave her name to the plain, right? To the plain of Nepeta. Right? Come on. Winner of the horse racing contest of the Olympic Games held by Hercules? Come on. This is a little too weaved together. A little too weaved together. Dardanus married this chick. A great flood occurred. They split. The others sailed to Samothrace, where Iasus or Iason was slain by Zeus for lying with Demeter. I saw, eyes. Remember, I sometimes Y was replaced by the J in 1524, so it's not Isis, it's Jesus, and he was slain by Zeus. So if what? Zeus is really, huh? Then who is Bacchus to Zeus? Because Dionysius is the brother of Jesus, right? And Dionysius's father is Zeus, so that's the grandfather slaying the grandson for fucking one of his wives. Or his concubine, or some woman he had. You never know with Zeus. You know how much weird shit he's recorded of doing. Right? As Baal, he's talking to a damn donkey. Hey, Shrek. If you take another step, that angel's gonna cut off the front part of your face and everything below it. And the donkey can see the angel, but Baal can't. But he's supposed to be a fucking sky god. And who is Demeter, right? Is that one of his wife? Goddess of harvest, right? I don't see Zeus's name up here. So it's just an act of jealousy. Dardanus and his people found the land poor, and so most of them set sail for Asia Minor. Oh, really? What about the slaying of Isis? Jesus. A different account of Virgil's Aeneid has Aeneid. Ooh, you know who that is right there. Right? King Aegeus of Africa. Right? He has him in a dream. In a dream, learn from his ancestral. Remember, the ancestors can talk to you, baby! Oh, girl, some dirt! Oh, it's a good child! That Dardanius and Father Jesus. And the Penates themselves originally came from Hesperia, afterwards renamed to Italy. And where is the Vatican, and where did the root of all this worship our forefather that was a king that was slain by Zeus or die come from? Oh, Jesus was Hebrew, he was a teacher, he lives in a hall, a big fucking lie. It's the same character. That's with his face, Luca, to the Lucis, to Iso or Luso. I think it's Iso because it's a name and there is no sentence there, so it's not following another word. Just like it's Ison here, the son of, or the grandson of. Right? Again, all this stuff, it all revolves, face of Lucis revolves around Italy, right? All this shit. This tradition holds, right? Because you were worshiping traditions. That Dardanus was a Tyrian prince and that his mother, Electra, was married to Corytheus, king of Tarquinia. Or Tarwania. Tarwinia, something like that. Formerly corny two. Me corn e two. Me corny two. Yes, I could be king there. I'm corny two. I would change the name. Yes, I would change the name to the city of Ben Al. Right. That's what I would do. I would be like, corny. I would, but now our capital would be trite. Right? They'd be like, right? Ben Al, Ben Alex, and his corny jokes from your home. Just reduce the volume and read the screen yourself. I'm sorry. Can't help it. So, Tradition holds that, these places. Other accounts make no mention of Arcadia or Hispania, though they are sometimes mentioned in the flood and speak about Dardania sailing on a hide raft as part of the flood story from Samothrace to Throde nearby Abydos. All accounts agree that Dardanius came from Troad from Samothrace and was there welcomed by King Teucer, right? Son of the river god Scamander, right? Oh boy, like salamander, Scamander, Scamander, right? Scamander! The river god's commander and another fucking nymph. God, man, what is with these guys? Like, this broad just pops out of water half naked and nobody questions that. What are those lines on your neck? Those are gills. Turn and run. I'm land barren forever. Dardanius married Batria, right? Bet. Yeah, Batea. His daughter, the daughter of Teucer, Dionysius mentions that Dardanius is. What the fuck? Oh, that's right. It's the writer. It's a different Dionysius, right? Dionysius mentioned that Dardanius' first wife had died at that point. He received land on Mount Ida from his father-in-law. There, Dardanius found the city of Dardanius, which became the capital of his new kingdom, and he later found the city of Thambra, all right, or Throde near to a town near Throde near Troy. No, excuse me, was a town in Throde near Troy. All right, so in honor of his friend Thymbrases, who is said to have been killed by Dardanius. Okay, so Dardanius waged war successfully against his neighbors, especially distinguishing himself against the Paphlagonians. All right, Paphlagonians in the ancient region on the Black Sea, coast of the north central Anatolia, situated between Bithynia. All right, so right in here. All right. Bithynia to the west and Pontus to the east. So that's where he ended up after his little sea wreck from Samoth or whatever. And thereby extending the boundaries of his kingdom. He had children with Beta Ilus and Erichthonius. Okay, so what I just showed you is from Paris, from what we see on screen in these silly ass movies, from not reading the book of, right, Iliad and Odyssey and right, the Aeneid. From seeing the movies, we know of Paris and we know of his brother, not Acre, but Hector, right? Now, from taking the mythological name, Hector, we can follow the bloodline all the way back, and we know it's not to Zeus, it's and we know it's to Baal. Anybody that questions what bloodline is Zeus from, they can always go right to the Bible and say, where is Baal from? And it will clearly tell you. You can type it on the YouTube. Okay, so when we know, we have our answers to a lot of things. Now, what was being said here is that this character. Now remember, Lucius, son of Bacchus, right? They're telling us that Dardanus, right, is the son of Zeus. So again, as we're reading this story of Dardanus, it's not who we think it is. Now, Dardanus had a brother. Dardanus' brother is Ilus. Excuse me, yeah, not Ilus, but how do we say this? Iasus. Right? ISIS is so important, they want to confuse you in history because half this shit has to do with them and half of it doesn't. But none of these have damn links about them. You know it's the same person as this right here because we read that. You know they from Arcadia. You know you got a city called Atlanta. You know up in Canada is called Arcadia. You know up in Maine is called Arcadia. All this stuff has been brought. They got an Athens motherfucking Ohio, an Athens motherfucking Pennsylvania. They got an Athens motherfucking New York, right? They got an Athens, Georgia. How come every state got to have Athens? You better figure this out. You better figure this out fast. Again, Paris had a dad. His name was Pyrrhum. Pyrrhum had a dad. His name was Laomedon. Laomedon had a dad. His name was Tros. Tros, right? Ilos, excuse me. Ilos. Lemedonian had a dad. It's Ilos. Ilos had a dad. It's Tros. Tros had a dad. He was the son of Eric Theonius. Whatever. You can see the shit right there. Eric Theonius, right? The son of Dardanus. Dardanus has a brother. His name's Easus. Easus. Easus is murdered by Zeus. What is the curse of the fall? To watch your children die. Now these people done left Portugal. Done brought their ass all the way over here and ended up in Turkey. Starting Troy. They so proud of him in Rome, what do they do? They wrote all these books, hours and hours of books on this motherfucker. And we don't know anything about it because we're being ignorant to all this. We prefer street cred. They get you nothing. All right here. In one land they're called this, in another land they're called that. So, you know, I'm at a point where I'm confused if I should keep reading or just leave it at that and just let it rest. You know, it's a shame that you have all these different organizations in the name of this character and it's not even the character's true name. It's a shame that they've told us thousands of years ago this happened and it wasn't like that at all. And clearly, the three brothers were warned not to worship and have nothing to do with, no idolatry towards them. Clearly, they were alive before the Moors were kicked out of Spain. They were alive when the Moors were kicked out of Spain. None of this shit's ancient. We haven't lived in a period that would respect the name ancient to be used. No different when the guys that created carbon testing fucking explain they're using it wrong. So, I don't know. there's it just becomes, bonus material, I guess, So, just as the gods had divided loyalties between the voyages of Odysseus and or Aengeus, king of Africa, here Venus, who favors the Portuguese, is opposed by Bacchus, who is here associated with the east of the east, excuse me, with the east, and represents the encroachment on territory. Now, didn't we just read how Dionysius, right? Dion Jesus, that's really what it says. Dionysius, didn't he end up, after his wife died, ended up on a raft and drifted into another kingdom? And then wasn't that kingdom in the east? Don't they always argue Turkey is in Asia? So aren't the Turks really just Lusitanians? Now, if this ode is to, right, again, you read right here, Bacchus is what? Now he's respected as, right? Fucking up other people's territory. Bacchus the invader, right? We encounter Da Gama's voyage in medias res, right? Opens in the midst of the plot. We've already rounded Cape Hope that at the urging of Bacchus, who is disguised as a Moor, the local Muslims plot to attack the explorer and his crew. How could he be disguised as a Moor if the Moors aren't around? So that means they're telling you of a story of when the Moors were in Spain, and Bacchus, who is Dionysius, right? Who has a brother named Isis, right? Who is Jesus, who was killed by Zeus, who is Baal. So he's one of the sons of Baal, right? See what's going on? It's all at the same time period. So, again, if this shit is happening then this Zeus taking over Kronos, right, and the regime change had to happen at the same time period too. How could it be different? What kind of lifespan could this Zeus have? See, Baal, who is Zeus, has to live at a time that he can go on to the Israelites and try to do this and try to do that. So Baal wouldn't be alive during the time of Moses, wouldn't be alive during the Empire of Egypt. He would be alive after all that. He would be alive after. Because the Israelites have to be in the situation that Balaam and Baal are working together. So that denotes a specific time period. Again, I go over these Baal Zeus shits. And we just get rid of this part. The Greeks called him Zeus, the Canaanites called him Baal. Right? So, it's just a bunch of wordplay. Again, Bacchus, who is Dionysius. Dionysius. Right? There's Bacchus right here. Watch. See this just opened up right here? It says Dionysius. Every time I say Bacchus, It's going to say Dionysius. They're the same person. Right. So, what is Lusus to Bacchus then? Well, this is all wrong then. Then he's not his son, he's his brother. So Lusus is Bacchus's brother, as Bacchus is Dionysius, or however you pronounce his name, and his brother is Isis. Lusus. Two scouts sent by the Gamma are fooled by a fake altar created by Bacchus into thinking that there are Christians among the Muslims. So Zeus is alive, right? Because he just killed Bacchus's brother. Dionysus is Bacchus, right? You see what they just said? Now think time period. There are Christians at this time period. Okay, so now you have to ask yourself, what period is this? Because, the Maccabees temple hasn't even fallen yet, and that's 300 years before zero. That's 250, 280 years before the death of Christ. They fucked up. They fucked up bad with this. So blatant. This book right here, it's all blatant. There is no Son of God. Don't you get it? God created Adam so Adam's bloodline could grow, so God could have his child out of Adam's bloodline when he chooses this suitor. Obviously, after Judgment Day, it wouldn't even care. It wouldn't even matter if somebody. It wouldn't. He created us. He's just like the computer is mythical to most of us. Everything he does is mythical to us. There's nothing you can do to mess up his plan. Anybody can create a time machine and change shit, it's him, right? But he wouldn't do that. He'd just send his angels to what? Chop your ass up. Think about how many times the Most High has used man to go on a long journey and destroy man. How many times has the Most High actually sent angels to destroy? It's rare. How wicked you gotta be to get the memo from above? The angel's got to sit there, paper, rock, scissors, trying to figure out who's got to go with the angel of death. Dude, he'd be fucking people up. I don't know if I want to go with him this time, right? I mean, so, again, Christians already exist. Christians and Muslims are fighting at the same time. Baal is still alive. Bacchus, his son, is alive. He's murdered his other son, right? Somebody at this point in history is coming up with the idea we've got to get the world to love the dead son. Thus, the explorers are lured into an ambush but successfully survive by the aid of Venus. Venus pleads with her father Jove. It's the same dude, Jupiter. Again, here you have Jupiter narrating, telling you about like how shit is with the Moors, and then you have his son Bacchus running around dressed up as a Moor. attacking the narrator of the fucking poem. I mean, yeah, I mean, that's pretty wild. That's pretty wild. Right? So then you have, right, pretend Zeus up in the air and pretend Zeus down on the ground, saying shit from both places. Right? When Zeus talks in the sky, he's Jove. When Zeus talks to the gr in the ground, he's, come on, he's Jupiter. But Jupiter's a planet. They fuck this up. And Jove is like a bird, right? It's a dove, right? And that's how. So obviously, along the way, we fucked up. We were supposed to name the planet Dove. I mean, Jove, right? Why is Venus the planet talking to Jove instead of Jupiter? Fucking idiots, dude. Oh, by Jove, who predicts great fortunes for the Portuguese in the East, the fleet, by stealing by the sword, right? By murder. If you take the sword out and start plunging in people and try to fire off some of those cannonballs, they're doing piracy during national piracy. A nation of pirates. If we play it this way, we can do it, guys. We can what? We can have great fortune. We can have others' fortune in the East. The fleet lands in Melini, where it is welcomed by a friendly sultan. Oh, fuck yeah. Hey, sultan, we're here to steal. Hey. Me and you heard this story before. This is America. Who came to America stealing shit? Setting up flags. Claiming other people's belongings. These aren't the fucking good guys. This is the cavalry of the devil. A friendly sultan welcomes them. After an appeal by the poet to Calliope, right? The Greek muse of poetry, epic poetry. Vasco da Gama begins to narrate the history of Portugal. He's on a fucking boat outside of Portugal, right? Okay, so he starts by referring to the situation of Portugal in Europe as the legendary story of Lusus and Varetius. And again, Varetius is a king, right? He's the most important leader of the Lusitanian peoples that resisted Roman expansion into the regions of Western Hispania and Western Iberia, where the Roman province of Lusitania, really, you resisted them, but they named the fucking province after you. If you resisted me, I would name your land dog shit. I would dog shit on fire, and then I would be launching dog shit on fire at you. But no, you were resistant to them, so they were so happy with your resistance that they just named the province after you and would be finally established after the conquest. Oh, they won conquest. No. Roman province, Roman conquest. So that doesn't make sense that they lost, but they said, fuck it. We'll just name it after them anyway. Oh well. So, again, did the Spanish and the Portuguese go to the Pope and say, where is the Pope located at in Italy? Did they go to the Pope and say, give us permission to go and steal shit from other people's? Yes, so they did. Okay, so they got permission slips. They went and they started stealing shit. And all along the way of stealing shit, they said, wait, before we fuck up these people's history, we need to write down our history. Our history starts with the legendary Lucius. And what does it say? Right? Son or it's the brother. I've been saying this wrong the whole time. Now that we get to the final bottom of it, it's the brother and companion of Bacchus until Zeus murders Lucis. And that's funny, because when we go to Lucis, it doesn't say like what happens to him, right? Unless this is it right here. This is the where he dies, right? When Zeus kills him, right? The love companion of a god of in a Spain, your fair bosom fixed his last abode. Fair bosom. That's that bitch he tried to fuck, and Zeus killed him. A fair, right? You've heard fair as, oh, ooh, she's a fair looking woman, right? You know what a bosom is. Fixed. So he hit that, and then he was hit, and then he was in the grave, and then, right? In those fair lungs, the blessed Elysium feigned, right? And he was buried at the, right, where the winding off of the gardenia robes and Douro quiets through the flowery groves, right? Here, with his bones, you creepy bastard, he left his deathless fame. What is a deathless fame? But we know what it means now. He was over here, right? No, we gotta go here. He was over here and he was slain by Zeus for lying with Demeter. Right? That's the last thing he's like. She was like, come get some. He was like, okay. He got it, and then he got it. And now they taught you to worship him. Right? Because again, Dardanus and his brother, now it's his father. You know, his father is Zeus. Right? It was slain by Zeus. Right? Again, when you go to the top, it's Dardanus, son of Zeus. I've been saying this wrong half the time, right? I thought it was his grandfather, the way it all read before. And now again, when you get to this story, it starts to iron things out that it's two brothers and their father, right? And now remember, now think about it. Isaac had a son, right? His son was Jacob, and Jacob had a son, and his firstborn was named Reuben, and Reuben fucked his concubine. Did he murder Reuben? Did he punish Reuben? Fuck yeah. Now you see the difference of the two nations, how they handle that situation. Think about that shit. 1-2. 2-1. All right, so we go back. Now, it says he started by referring the situation of Portugal and Europe as the story of Lucius and Boethius. This is followed by the passage of the meaning of the Portuguese nationality and when by an enumeration of the warrior deeds of the first dynasty kings. All right. So, from Dom Alfonso Henriquez to Don Dom Fernando, right? Episodes that stand out include Enges Manias, is known as the as a Portuguese nobleman. Okay, so that doesn't really sound like an episode. That's a person. Okay, this person and the Battle of Arique. Right, and during Dom Alfonso Henriquez's reign, the beautiful Maria, the 16th century Portuguese, and the Battle of Salado. They're fighting for Italian dressing. The Battle of the Salad, Rio Salido. known as the Battle of Tarifa, was a battle of the armies of King Alfonso IV of Portugal and King Alfonso IX of Castile against those of the Sultan Abu al-Hasan Ali of the Marinid dynasty, and Yusuf the First of Granada. Is this what these dumb motherfuckers are trying to call themselves, Yusuf, and they're trying to be Yusuf? Like the Sufi? These people need to study their own shit. Dr. Yusuf, you fucking fakes. Fakes, I tell you. Not even good fakes. Being hack fakes, they're shit. Oh man, my fucking shoulder. Ugh. All right, battle of salad. Formosissima Maria, the most beautiful Formorian ever. Canto 5, Vasco continues the narrative of, excuse me, the history of Portugal by recounting the story of the House of Avias, dynasty of Portugal, which flourished during the Renaissance period, expansion glo power globally. From the 1383 to 1385 crisis, the interregnum, right, the civil war. I would imagine this is the black and white war. I don't know. Maybe not. Who knows? Which no crowned king of Portugal reigned. No, it can't be, because. Yeah, I'm just gonna go ahead. Yeah. Just ignore my comment on the black and the white, because we're going to see the black Spanish over here. We're going to see the black Portuguese over here. So who knows? And the Yao family, that's familiar to us. And I don't give a shit what picture they show us, but that has come up before. I'm not saying it's with the Portuguese king in Virginia. I'm just saying that name has come up before, because again, he's going to India, not America. All right, so I'm not saying the two at all. All right, from the crisis till the moment of the reign of Don Manuel, when the armada of Vasco da Gama sails to India. The navigation of the crisis, excuse me, the narrative of the crisis of 1383 to 85, which focuses mainly on the figure Nuno Alvares Pereira, is a general of great success. The crisis arise from Portuguese independence from Castile, that's what it was, and he later became a mystic and was, you say, beautified by the people. Trying to, there, that became again. Beatified by the people, by Pope Benedict. He became a mystic. you gotta love this. You can't make it up. Hey, right, and at the Battle of Azubarato, Baroto, Portal. They use the same picture for both, right? Kingdom of Portugal and the Kingdom of and the Crown of Castile. All right, so Castile is its own county, so to speak. You know, think of Castile like that's just what's best. You know, county, its own kingdom, and so Portugal against Castile. Castile's in Spain. I did say Kingdom of Portugal, right? Yeah, Kingdom of Portugal. Basically, that's Portugal against Spain. Spain's territories aren't necessarily settled yet. In a truce that comes up later, they're divide by a certain river, and that's just the mark that still stands today. That's why Portuguese looks real small and Spain looks real big. would be the, comparison between the two. So we're gonna go down here and the journey to India. Following the incident, the poem narrates the maritime journey to India, an aim that Dom Yao II did not accomplish during his lifetime, but would come true for Dom Manuel, whom the rivers Indus and Ganges appeared in his dream, foretelling the future glories of the Orient. So, I'm telling you, Dom Manuel had this dream, and again, the reigns of the prefect prince was king of Portugal. So this is the king of Portugal that's fighting against the king of Castile, right, at the time. And then when he dies, the new king comes into play, Dom Manuel. All right, so this canto ends with sailing of the Armada and the sailors, in which are surprised by the prophetical, pessimistic words of the old man who was on the beach. Now, remember, the old man is Nereus, right? The daughter, son of the sea. When the earth you poop in and the sea you pee in come together and have a child, it's Nereus. This is the old man who keeps popping up, right? Old man who was on the beach among the crowd. This is the episode of the old man of the Restelo. All right. So the story moves. Now remember, these people are going all over the place and they can just freely talk to anybody. There's no language barrier at all. Right. The story moves on to the king of Melinde describing the journey of the Armada from Lisbon to Melinde during the voyage. Excuse me. The sailors see the Southern Cross and Saint Elmo's fire. Now, the Southern Cross that everybody talks about is a constellation, all right, in the southern sky that is centered on the four bright stars in a cross shape, basically known as the Southern Cross. Saint Elmo's fire is a weather phenomenon in which luminous plasma is created by a corona discharge from a rod-like object such as a mast, spine, or chimney. Now again, luminous meaning visible, so it's a plasma discharge. It's created by the corona discharge from a rod. So the rod, such as a mast, a spire, a chimney, or an animal horn in an atmospheric energy electric field. So again, if you have a rod and you're in an electric field, a discharge occurs and it is in the shape of plasma. All right, the maritime whirlwind. I don't know why they say that, as if Saint Elmo's fire is the maritime whirlwind, because they're telling you Saint Elmo's fire, and even the image displays it comes off the mast, because presumably it's static shock, no different from taking two sticks and rubbing them together to create fire. It sparks, right? The different things that create sparks, and out at sea, this creates sparks. So, a face of variety of dangers, obstacles such as inhospitality, or excuse me, the hospitality of the natives in the episode of Vernalo Veloso, whatever, the fury of a monster in the episode of the giant Adamasaur. Now again, that's when he takes the persona, the Cape Hope takes the personification of a giant. And again, when I said that, you didn't believe me, and it's telling you right there, episode of the giant, and the disease and death caused by scurvy. Now scurvy is what? Lack of vitamin C. Is a disease rotating, yes, from lack of vitamin C. Weakness, feeling tired, sore arms, sore legs without treatment, diseased red blood cells, gums, changes to the hair. So without treatment, your body starts to fall apart. You need vitamin C. All right. So and Canto ends with the poet's censure of his contemporaries who despise poetry. All right, and Canto's six. And the narrator, the Armada sails from Melinae, guided by a pilot to teach them the way to Calicut. Bacchus, seeing that the Portuguese are about to arrive in India, asks for help from Neptune. Now, is he above? Is he below? What the hell's going on? Is he a human? So again, I would suppose that they're saying these are beings that are able to be in different places at willpower, right? So he's up in this chamber of these people or beings that claim to be gods. I'm just trying to describe how they show it in their movies, right? Because a lot of this doesn't make sense, right? Bacchus, right? Who before? I'm presuming that they're trying to say he took the shape of a man on Earth, dressed himself like a Moor, and tried to attack this group previously. Now he's no longer on Earth. He's in, let's say, the lower heavens, right? He's in the lower heavens making decisions or gambling with the other lower gods. And his gamble, he sees they're about to arrive at India, and he's trying to prevent this, obviously, and he asks Neptune for help. Now, again, Bacchus is the son of Zeus. Zeus is supposed to be, right, in this room too, right? But he's being called Jove there instead of Jupiter. But Neptune, who is Poseidon, right, he's being called his planet name because, again, they're at planetary positions at this point, right? Who convenes with the council of the sea gods, who, right? That's what Aquaman always does, right? Whose decision to support Bacchus and unleash powerful winds to sink the Armada. So the council of the sea gods are in control of the winds. They're not really in control of the water. That doesn't make sense. And then, while the sailors are listening to Velasco telling the legendary and chivalrous episode of some shit, the 12 men in England, a storm strikes. Da Gama, seeing the near destruction of the caravels. Caravels are ships. Remember, they're in a fleet. He prays to his own god. Really, the nymphs you've been asking shit from the whole way. The deity of po the moose of poetry you've been begging and sucking off her titties for some time. You're not gonna call any of them in your time of calamity. But who's your god that you called on? But it is Venus who helps the Portuguese by sending the nymphs to seduce the winds and calm them down. What does seduce mean? Is she the wind? So all the personifications of rivers and forests and lakes gather together and say, we're gonna, the winds? And once, of course, they have this rump, they're out of energy, so they're just calm. And it's just after the storm, the Armada sights Calicut, and Da Gama gives thanks to God. But you already said Venus helped you. The canto ends with the poet speculating about the value of fame and glory reached through great deeds. Like stealing. What do the Portuguese do when they get to India? Do the Indians just have people of India just happily say, we have too much. Take our stuff. We do not need these things. We live in a different way than you. We found gold, we do not want it. We found silver, we do not want it. Take and be happy. Do you think that's the words that they would say to another nation? Hungry to explore? Are you here to learn our customs? No, we're here to take your gold and silver. Canto 7, after condemning some of the other nations of Europe, who, in his opinion, failed to live up to Christian ideals. The poet tells the Portuguese fleet reaching, again. Did he just fucking say he's talking shit about other people for not keeping up with Christian ideals and he just bowed to nymphs and Venus and this and that and called a fucking planet God? Glass house. Fucking shit, man. I mean, what the hell? I don't know, buddy. You're not living up to Christian ideals. You need to bow your ass over and pray to nymphs. You should be, again, these are Christian ideals. Can we not see that? If the Christians are worshiping, the sons of false gods mentioned in the Ten Commandments. Well, these are Christian ideals. That's why it's not another nation just taking over, right? Like other nations try to do. It's just a whole different ball of shit. The poet tells of the Portuguese fleet reaching the Indian city of Calicut. A Muslim named Man Kaid greets the fleet and tells the explorers about the lands they have reached. King Samorin hears the newcomers, summons them. A governor official of the king called Catul leads the Portuguese king, who receives them well, and Catul speaks with Monoclade to learn more about the new arrivals. And the Catul, now it's the Catul, then goes to the Portuguese ships himself to confirm what Manasseid told him, has told him, and is treated well in Canto 8. The Catul sees the number of paintings that depict significant figures and events from Portuguese history, all of which are detailed by the author. Bacchus appears in a vision to a Muslim priest of the Samoan court and convinces him that the explorers are a threat. Well, he was right about that. The priest spreads the warning among the Catuls and the court of owls, prompting the Samoan to confront Da Gama on his intentions. Da Gama insists that the Portuguese are traitors, not buccaneers, pirates. The king then demands proof that Da Gama's ships from his ships, but when he tries to return to the fleet, Da Gama finds that the Catul, who have been corrupted by the Muslim leaders, refuses to lend him a boat at the harbor and holds him prisoner. Da Gama manages to get free only after agreeing to have all the goods on the ship brought ashore to be sold. So they said, you're here to fucking sell, sell or die. Cantos 9, the Muslims plot to detain Portuguese until the annual trading fleet from Mecca can arrive to attack them. Now again, they have no way of getting word to a ship that's coming down to tell them to attack somebody else. So I don't really know if that's really true. But Monticade tells the Gamma of the conspiracy, and the ship escapes from Calicut. I keep saying Calcutta, I'm sorry. To reward the explorers for their efforts, Venus prepares an island for them to rest on and ask her son Cupid to inspire their needs with desire for them. Ew. Yuck. In Nereids, they are the daughters of fuck, how do you say his name? Ner what? Nereus. Right? So the Nereids are sea nymphs. 50 daughters of the old man of the sea. Oh, it says right there, the old man of the sea. See? Sea. Holy sea. Oh, shit, no. Right? And the keys, right? We have the keys to hell. And death, because we're the Lusitanians. You smelly fuckers, so, when the sailors arrive on the Isle of Love, the ocean nymphs make a pretense of running, but surrender quickly. Oh, they make cutesy pie of it. Oh, look at that. Oh my God, there's men. Oh, girls run. Oh, this is like your fucking teenage beach movie, right? During this the su sumptuous feast on Love Island. Half sea creature. She's got clam down there. What the fuck, man? This is sick. Right? I don't need anybody's opinion if it's sick. I fucking know it's sick, dude. Come on, man. Yeah, you can take your most needy fucking moment and throw a goddamn fish bitch down in front of me, man, and I will fuck you up. I won't even touch that fucking thing. Get this fucking tuna based thing out of me, man. Get the fuck. Ah, dude, I just want to eat a full meal and just throw it up right now, right in my mouth. Look at how they write this shit, too. Right? Isle of Love, yeah. They make pretense out running, but they sir, come on. They played coy with us, but we got them in the end. I only lost my leg and arm. The sea cow was hungry, so I fed myself to her. Why, man? Why do they even have this in here? Damn it, they want you to know. They fucked mermaids. So, Tethys, the Titan daughter of your asshole, Uranus. I mean, who in the fuck writes this shit? Your anus. And Gaia, oh God, it's your butt in the dirt again, man. Sister wife of the Titan Oceanus, and the mother of the river gods and the Oceanids. Oh God, you mean the river nymphs that personify themselves as humans, but they're really not humans, they're something different and weird. Oh fuck, man, this is just nasty. So, who is now the lover of the Gamma? Oh my goodness, dude. Who are you praying to? Oh, the epic poem, bitch. You're not gonna get any more of my fishy treats if I catch you praying to other things. Prophecies of the future of Portuguese exploration and conquest. Oh, really? That's great. You will enslave Indians and send them in the mines to their death. You will buy licenses from your government to seed the people once the men are dead. What do you mean the people? It's only women and children left alive then. Okay, it's a license to rape the inhabitants that's left over after you kill the fucking men. That's the kind of prophecy she was telling you. Fuck you, your people will be great thieves and murderers. Excuse me. She tells of Durant Pacquiao, right? Portuguese Achilles, get the fuck out of here. In his defense, Cochin, whatever, at the battle, Cochin, whatever, she tells of all this shit. His son, Dalmida, and his son combined with the Guadahari Egyptian fleets, the deeds to this and that. I don't care shit about this. Castro. Tethys then guides Degama to a summit and reveals to him a vision of how Ptolemaic, the Ptolemy model. Is that why it's called Ptolemaic? The geocentric model is a superseded description of the universe with the Earth at the center. So you're telling me this motherfucker is talking to some weird ass sea creature, fake god shit, and she tells him the only thing of importance is it's a flat Earth, motherfucker, and the Earth, you're at the center of the universe. Wow. Thanks. Come on, I'm just gonna skip this, right? The tour continues with glimpses of Asia and Africa. The legend of the martyrdom of St. Thomas in India is told at this point. Alright, so Thomas is dead at this point. So, right, so Christianity already happens. My bad about that earlier. Again, the way it's written, Christianity couldn't have happened yet because, right, Zeus is speaking. It's just this drunk man's writings. The only thing that's really true in here is about how these people die, how they killed other people. Obviously, this incident that occurs then leads to the reasoning of why Portugal is going to go into the India and take over their fucking, their stores, basically, their trafficking of anything. Finally, this thing relates the voyage of Magellan, the epic concludes with more advice to young King Sabatio, right? I'm going to stop here because this isn't really on par with these other books because I guess it is. You know, again, they give this narration of beings that they have no ability to know what the fuck they're saying. So, do these beings say any of these things? Of course not. So, you know, to a great degree, it is a mixture of bullshit as it, you know, like we were reading earlier, and they explain what the mockery is, the Ovitia Rima. It's not a mock work. It's a work that is showing things of history and moments of this exploration of all these vessels that hit the sea for, of course, the crown of Portugal. The things that I doubt are the parts where Zeus speaks, where Bacchus speaks. The problem is the Bacchus incident seems to be the cause and the effect seems to be the ocean nymphs being told, or the river nymphs going, being told, the daughters of the old man of the sea being told to go and fraternize, you know what word I really want to use, with the wind, and the daughters of the ocean being told to go and fraternize with sailors. So the personifications of the rivers are told to F the wind, and the personification of the, right, but that's not even true. It literally says they're sea nymphs too, right? So both of them are. So again, in a story like this, do you believe the situations with the nymphs and the men? Do you believe the situations of the gods, the minor gods, talking and gambling on people? And oh, excuse me, it's getting late here, and trying to interfere with these people. That's the whole thing. It plays too much on people's beliefs. For you to believe it happens this way, again, I cried to God, but Venus intervened. I don't know. You know, it's to each his own. The goal of this for me to each of the viewers is to show they've been worshiping this character for a long time. It's not the character that they present to you. The image that you see of Luca is not what you think it is. It's clearly a half man, half something else that was struck down by his father. The actions that he did before this made everybody in the land very happy with him and very proud of him. He obviously settled with the Lusitanian people because, again, when they say the history of Portugal, the most important thing is these two founders, Vitiarius, you know, he comes up again right there. So, and of course, Lucius. So, I'm just going to end it there. With that being said, appreciate your time. I appreciate the help that you give as assistants. Your viewership and donations help us thrive ahead every day. Again, nobody wants to sit around for 2.5 hours making a video about what has tricked the world. No one wants to. Again, when you go to the movie theater, do you sit there and say, I want to pay money to watch a documentary or anything that is like that? So, there is, in some people's heart, a reason to view this stuff. Yeah, I'm kind of here for you. Shalom, everybody. May the Most High bless you.